Good evening.
Well done.
Thank you. What is giving me? Okay. We want to quickly look at choosing statistical tests. Now, without wasting time, we are all researchers. One major problem people face is how to choose the appropriate statistical tests for a particular study. Calling statistician for the type of test you carry out is only second to calling statistician for sample size determination. The common reason many people call statistician is, I want to do my study, I don't know how to determine the sample size. The second one is, which statistical test will I do? Maybe in writing the statistical aspect, statistical session, or maybe after the data is are collected, the right statistic to use has been big problem. That is why you even can, some people do funny things by even running something like ANOVA for ethnicity. The reason being that when they code, you know, they can code anything in SPSS. Maybe the ethnicity, you code it 1, 2, 3, 4. So the computer, if you just, if somebody that doesn't know how statistics, just know how to press SPSS computer, you can go and run, even compare ethnicity by, say, they doing ANOVA. So let's quickly look at what determines type of statistical analysis. There are three major things. The other one, which is sample size, not put here because it's actually it determines it better. If it's not enough, it can prevent you from running the test you want to run. Now, study design, variable or data type, the assumption about the distribution of the variable. When you look at the study design, this is just a snapshot. So I don't want to, because it's not all the part of study design that determine the type of statistic you use, but there are aspects of the study design. Or know if we have different ways of presenting, categorizing study design. But the commonest and the way the commonest way people are familiar with is dividing into experimental and experimental. If you influence the phenomenon you are studying, it's experimental design. You don't have to be in laboratory. You can even, by giving counseling, health education, it's experimental. By giving drug, it's experimental. Whatever you do, even giving something nutrient, it's experimental. Even prescribing exercise, it's experimental. Anything that you do that may influence what you are measuring. Like now, if you want to study BMI and anything, you may prescribe exercise, it's experimental, because the exercise has a way of reducing the weight. So you are studying the weight. If one of the things you prescribe in your study has a way of influencing the what you are studying, it's experimental design. But you get to know that whether study is experimental or not experimental has nothing to, it does not determine the type of statistics you carry out per se. Even though people that perform do experimental design tend to use certain type of statistics. The what determines the statistics you carry out is not whether It's experimental because the scientist does not know if maybe somebody you intervene or not. You're going to see what statistics know about. You know, when you look at this description, by nature, experimental is never one sample. It has cooperative group, comparison group. Experimental design, you cannot take sample once. You cannot take measurement once in experimental design. It has to be at least two times. That is the nature of experimental. Either maybe whether you are taking, you are using two independent group or three, or you are using you are using only one group, but you must do your carry out your observation at least two times. That is the nature of experimental design. Now, the observation that you see here, you now see that it can be descriptive or analytical. That's where we are going. The descriptive just means one group, one sample. The analytical, there is comparison. You must have at least two. Can you see now? We have already said that in experimental design, by nature, it must be at least two. When you come to design that is not experimental, observational design, you can have one group, you can have the one that have comparison group, that is two, three, or many groups. So you see that if you are to reclassify, even the experimental design is an analytical study. So you can, that's why some people describe study to descriptive and analytical. When under the analytical, you now put observational and experimental. But the drawback of that one also is that the descriptive studies are observational. Just like the way you have done it now, you say experimental, observational. And under the experimental version, not analytical and descriptive. But even the experimental is analytical because it has comparison group. So if you do in the other way, say analytical, descriptive. And under the analytical, you cannot put experimental and observational. Of course, descriptive is observational, whichever way. But that won't make one statistical sense to say analytical and observational. And descriptive rather. Analytical and descriptive. That is, you are telling you descriptive is one group, the other one more than one group. Simple. And the experimental by nature usually more than one group. So computer knows what statistics know. Are you dealing with one group or you are dealing with more than one group? It's not whether it is experimental or observational. So the statistic, what determine the type of test you carry out, are you dealing with one group descriptive or you are dealing with more than one group, which is analytical? We now know that experimental fall under that analytical. So that is why whether you do intervention, maybe experimental or not, it does not actually reflect your choice of analysis. It's whether are you dealing with one group or more than one group. Now you go further. Even though that's what I just put here, single or multiple number of samples, that is group you are dealing with, G1 or more, multiple just means 2, 3, 4, or whatever. Now, it doesn't end there. If it is more than one group, how are the group arranged? Are they independent group? Independent group means those two, either two or three, whatever, they are separate group of people. You sample them from separate group of people. Then all they are dependent. They are dependent mean pair or repeated. I say repeated because when you say pair, it means that you are talking of two things. That is before and after. But you can do repeated. You can do 1, 2, 3 from the same set of you are taking measurement in succession. That is what they call repeated measure. So pair or repeated measure means that it's the same group of people. That's what I explained. Independent sample. Sample selected from one population is not related to the sample selected from the other population. Like when you say you do your case control, or you do your urban rural, or you do experimental control, that is subject control. In as much as there are two separate groups, it can be three groups. You can have maybe you have two drugs you are testing against placebo, group drug A, group B, then the other one, placebo C. The issue there is that you have separate group. The group one or group A, the subjects there are different from group B or group C. That is mean of independent. But for dependent, peer mean maybe you in the same group you take measurement. You say each member of one corresponds to the man, a member of other sample. You are taking sample now. You take sample again. If it is peer, it's the same set of people. What do you mean? If you measure somebody Ebola, measure the blood pressure, you record everything as number one in your system. When you come back again, take the measurement. You must be able to know that number one was Ebola, and in this one you now combine. So when you are entering into your package software, you make sure that number one, it was you enter number one, Ebola as number one. What you get from Ebola again must be continue number one in front. That is fair. What it means that you have two measurements before and after, even if it is three times, four times, but you is from the same group of subjects, that is pair or repeated. Or match, in a situation where you use the word match, if maybe right hand, left hand, though some people also they use my if you have one particular subject and you try to look for a match in many respects, in age, in sex, in many things, you can use this also as match. But the natural thing that match is used, are used like high. You measure triangular pressure left and right eye. They appear, they are naturally matched. The right hand, left hand, right thumb, left thumb, right leg, left leg, right ear, right ear, left ear. Molar, upper lie, right, upper left. You know everything. Right breast, left breast, anything. Left and right occur as pair naturally. In that case, it's the same people you sample, but you have measurement for right, you have the measurement for left. In that case, it's dependent observation. So that is one. So we have talked about the study designer. So what we are interested in study design when it comes to statistical analysis is whether it's one group or more than one group. If it's more than one group, are they independent group or they are pair group? Simple or repeated measure. That's all. We're going to see how relevant these things are. Then the second criterion, you said, was a variable type. So here now we're talking of, are you dealing with quantitative variable or categorical variable? That is, are you dealing with numerical, something that can be given number, or you are dealing with something that cannot be given number? If it can be given number, is the number fresh? Is it continuous? That is, does he assume decimal or he only assume integer, which is whole number? Like number of children now is 1, 2, 3, 4. You cannot say 2.5 children. No. Something that, no, it's only inanimate something you can say, oh, have 3.5 block, or 3.5 yam, or whatever. But for a children and other animate subjects, also other things, it's difficult. When you are counting, it's whole old number. So that one has to be taken into consideration. So if you can give number, numerical, if it's numerical, is it discrete or continuous? If it is categorical, is it nominal or ordinal? That is, can you order it? That is what you have on the screen here. Variable. Scale mean numerical. Measurement, is it measure or count? Something that has decimal is considered to be measured. Those is something that you cannot give decimal, it's whole number, considered to be count. You are counting it. So, continuous, under continuous, you know, you can take any value, like height, you can take any, your height can be 1.72, 1.702. No infinite number of value. So if it is discrete, it's going to be whole number. If it is categorical, if it's ordinal, that is order, like socioeconomic status. You know, upper, lower, middle, upper, middle, lower. Educational status, no formal, primary, secondary, tertiary. And some other things like military, nursing profession, in many cases. Socioeconomic status, anything that has to do with socioeconomy is always like that. If you can give endless example, no military, nothing. All of them have to do with profession, you know? And that's what leads to socioeconomic status also. Because different cadre, level of income, even level of where you live. So the social and holding up. Then there are some questions, the attitude question I will put on like scale. Like something that you cannot, you know, some of the time, if some you cannot quantify, but you cannot give value, numerical value, but it's in hierarchy, it's ordinal. So, but anything that does not have rank, you cannot order it. Like ethnicity, like language, all those things is not order. Like a Nigerian geopolitical zone. Is they are all nomina, sex, nomina. Because you just belong to one category, there's nothing that shows that one category is higher than the other. If we arrange, we can arrange in alphabetical order for ease of analysis, whatever. That's why in Nigeria now, Abia state is usually number one state, while Zamfara is number two, last. It's not me, the one they list last in on the cassette. Doesn't mean that Abia is number one, Zamfara is the last. It's just the sex. So every state is equal, but we just decide for convenience, we arrange alphabetically. So you're going to see how that will contribute. The last one, which I didn't actually show on the slide, is whether there's an assumption that these variables follow a particular distribution. And it is the numerical variable, the continuous one that you assume to follow, that is this one that doesn't, because the reason is very simple. It has infinite number of values. So you can only understand it by looking at the pattern it assumes in the population. How is going on by the number of people that have the characteristic increases, the value increases. It reaches a point like weight, like height now. As number of people that have, as you know, adults that weigh 40. They are very rare. The 50, the people that weigh 50 are more than the people that weigh 40. If you add up that weigh 60, I'm more than the one that weigh 50. The other that weigh 70, I'm more than the one that weigh 60. But if you are going up, the other that weigh 80 is less than the one that weigh 70. 90 is less than the 80. So it goes down. So if you are plotting it, it goes up and comes down. That's what brings the normal distribution, the bell shape that goes up and comes down. And when you look at it, the one side of the image is a mirror image of the other one. It's bilaterally symmetrical. So when you can assume that any variable that can follow that pattern, and especially these are continuous variables that follow that pattern, the test you do is a parametric, because that's how those things exist in the population. To follow the pattern in the population, we call it parametric test. Then there are some variables that may not follow that. Or even normally, the variable that normally you think you follow normal distribution may not follow it in your own study. You may do it, it may be skewed, it may not follow it. That's part of it. So if by the time you explore it, you see that it doesn't follow it, you cannot do some tests. So those tests that can be done, if you can assume, you can follow assumption, you can establish that, okay, these assumptions are met, that these variables follow normal distribution. There are some other assumptions. It's not only that one, but that's the most important. The second most important is the variances, homogeneity of variance. The variances among this, between or among the separate group must be the same. The variances must not vary much. Variances must not vary. That is, variation must not be too much, so that you can say averagely that the variation the same among the different group you want to compare. Even though the mean and some other thing you want to compare may be different, that is why you are comparing, you are seeing if there's any difference. But the variances must not be too much different. That's part of the assumption. So there are tests, those tests that you need that type of assumption to carry out, they are called parametric tests. And those ones you don't need, they are called non-parametric tests. You see, by nature, all the tests you carry out for anything that will not even follow normal distribution anyway, like anything categorical, anything yes, categorical, both the nominal and ordinal. All their tests are non-parametric because you don't need that assumption. But if you come, even the discrete, even the numerical, the one that are discrete also, you cannot assume that is when you are counting, one that are this discrete numerical, you know, you cannot, you just have to, you cannot be sure that it follows normal distribution. It's only these one that are continuous. So but even those things that like weight now, you believe to be continuous variable, you may not still carry it out because in your study, you now find that the weight is not normally distributed. You still have to use non-parametric tests. So let's quickly look at these tests that are divided into three here now. There are some tests where you compare comparison, though it's just the way all of them is almost the same thing, just the way of conceptualizing it. When you say comparison, you are not dealing with, okay, you have different groups, you have different groups, you are comparing this thing among different groups. But that group also is an exposure variable. Now let's quickly look at it gradually. Now, in these tables now, all those things I've just said will come into play. All those three things: the study design, the type of variable, and the assumption. Whether you can make assumption about this variable, all of them will come into place to determine on this table. Let's quickly go through. Look at, if you have two independent groups, the average just mean that comparing means between dependent groups, means between dependent groups. So the dependent variable, of course, has to be numerical. That's K mean numerical. The language is very good because if you are using software, especially SPSS now, when you are, it will tell you scale, ordinal, and nominal. Numerical is the scale. When they say scale, it means that it's number, ordinal and nominal. Though ordinal doesn't mean that it cannot, even ordinal also can be represented by number. But that number is assigned number, it's not the real value. It's assigned number, it's a crude number you just give. Like scale now, you have five options. You now put the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. That's not their values, you that give their arbitrary value. Or maybe severity of the disease, mild, moderate, severe, that's very mild, moderate, severe, very severe. You know, you now give 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. It's an ordinal scale. You give that number is arbitrary. But the number that discrete and continuous are, they are not arbitrary. They are the real value, the number of children. You have five children, that's the real value. It's not a crew. So scale here means continuous, that is quantitative, and the independent variable, that's dependent variable, outcome variable is the dependent variable. The independent variable, explanatory variable, they call it explanatory variable, or factor, or determinant. The explanatory variable, it's nominal, that is binary, because they say average of two independent groups. So you are having two groups that are separate groups, independent. I think we have explained the word independent now before, the type of the group. So binary, that is binary means there are two groups. So the independent variable, like sex now. If you want to look at maybe income, or blood pressure between male and female. Blood pressure is quantitative scale. The independent variable, which is the sex, is male or female, it's two, general. That's an example here. So because that is scale, is continuous variable, before you carry out independent t-test. T-test, but it has to be independent because there are different type of t-test. Independent is the t-test for two separate group of people. Because the male and the female, they are separate group of people. When the measurement you take from the male is different from the male, so all the ones that are male, they are male. All those ones that are female, they are female. So t-test. So if paravention, maybe that your blood pressure does not follow normal distribution, maybe skew because there may be some extraneous outliers can happen when you do, even though normally it should be normally distributed by nature, but in your own sample it's not. You do Mann Whitney test or Wilkinson ransom. You that were in and you training with it, you weekend training with it on comparing two means. We talk about t-test and the non-parametric counterpart. I think they are familiar with all this language now. Mann Whitney, Wilkinson. Wilkinson, they are two different things, but they are, you know, Wilkinson ransom, then Mann Whitney test. Wilkinson ransom was described by Frank Wilkinson. Mann Whitney was described by two people, Mann. Ransom Mann and Whitney. They are two different people. That's how they put Mann. Whitney, Ernie Whitney, and some man, put of them. Now, let's look at average G's of three independent. The first one was two independent group, but this one are three group, three or more, three plus, three or more, and is continuous variables of scale, and the category source is nominal, one way ANOVA. So ANOVA. Whenever you are comparing mean between many groups. So like next weekend now, this weekend I will be having training workshop on using SPSS. But the next weekend is going to be workshop on ANOVA. ANOVA. Then if that thing does not now follow normal distribution, the non-parametric counterpart is Kukawalis test. Kukawalis. Yes. Now we can also use median test. No, we explained that in the last training we had, the last workshop we had. The average of difference between pairs. Can you see now? Here now, this number one and number two, they talk about independent. Then you can have pair different between two pairs. That is before and after. They are not the two group are not independent. They are dependent. That's what we call match of pair. Like weight. So what you look maybe before and after. Weight before and after diet is an example. So the scale, the dependent variable is numerical, is continuous. Independent variable is the condition or time. When you say condition, you know, somebody was asking me in one of the workshop, said that this pair doesn't mean that it's for experimental design. No. Of course, the condition here means experimental. Condition means that maybe you subject them to a particular condition. Time also, sometimes without even compare, you can take measure only two times, believing that nature, maybe over time, but it's not experimental because it's not you, whatever changes that happen over 1 year or 6 months, it's not because you did anything, but by nature, maybe nature did something. So in that case, it's not experimental, it's observational. So you can do it also. So when you do something before and after, so there is time in between. The time may be maybe just time. It may be during that time you do something. That's where you do your experiment. Whichever way the man with the statistic is not interested in what you do in between the time anyway. When you are interpreting your results, yeah, you may be interested in that. But the statistic to analyze it for you, the statistical test, the thing is from the same set of people before and after. Peer t-test. And if it doesn't follow, it's the difference now that it should follow normal distribution. That is, when you remove the way before from after, or before after from before, whichever way, the difference follow normal distribution. If it doesn't, Wilkinson sign and test. So there's a difference between Wilkinson ransom and Wilkinson sign and. So we did that in our workshop because I cannot be explaining the difference now because it will take time. That is why we actually have workshop for that. Where workshop is, that is not lecture. It's workshop where you see that you take time to explain and you demonstrate. There's time to explain and demonstrate. And you ask the participant to participate also. We ask you to demonstrate it also. So we have been doing that on Zoom with our SPSS. So in fact, I have discovered that it is even easier to teach the SPSS on Zoom than physically. So let's leave it for now. Then the three plus measurement on the same subject. If that is, the same is, you know, is paired also, but this one, the first one is paired. This one is repeated measure. That is more than two times. That is repeated. You cannot say pair because pair has to do with two. More than two times repeated measure. It is the same thing. No, the time in between, then repeated measure and over. It's an over also. We call it repeated measure and over. It's a form of factorial and over. I'm going to explain that. Then, if it does not follow the different, not follow normal distribution, Friedman's test. Friedman and over. We call it Friedman and over. Now, let's move. This, if you look at it here, we are looking, if you look at, what is it, comparison? Yeah, if you look at it, it's like everything we are comparing between groups, they are quantitative variable. We are comparing between quantitative variable. We are comparing between two or three groups or more than two groups. So let's look at tests of association. Well, that is, we are trying to look at variable. Like for the first, even the first one is the same thing, but it's just the way you conceptualize. But here now, it is easy for people to conceptualize this one. You see, association between two variables. Instead of say different between groups, people, organization between this and this. Like if you are looking at between two continuous variables, both of them, they are like now, salt intake, continuous variable. Blood pressure is a continuous variable. We are looking at association or age and blood pressure. Both of them are continuous variable. Looking at association between them. Since both of them are continuous variable on both sides, you cannot be talking of category on both sides because they are limited number of value. If you have to categorize them, you are changing them from continuous to categorical. Like when you categorize your age, or you can categorize your blood pressure also. Is greater than this between this and this. In that situation, they have changed them to category. They are no more continuous variable. So in the way they exist naturally as scale, continuous, is piercing correlation. Because it's correlation that look at association, the degree of association between two numerical variables. Numerical. If both of them are continuous, yes, is piercing. But in a situation where you have at least one of them is not continuous, maybe this week or rank, like it maybe it's like a scale. Maybe you are looking at the age and the attitude of a person on a like a scale. In that case, age is continuous, but that attitude you have put on like a scale is not continuous, it's ordinary. It's ordinary, even though you give it number 1, 2, 3. So that's one thing with correlation because it has to do with number anyway. But this other number is ordinary, why this one is continuous? So use Spearman correlation. Also use Kendall also, especially where, because that also is for non-parametric. So that Spearman is non-parametric, while spacing is parametric. Now, if you are trying to predict the value of this one is more than association between variables, not just as is not so association only. Well, the world is relationship and association, some people use it in a simply different way. Some people say it's the same. Well, if you feel that it's the same, okay? But if you feel it's not the same, some people feel that the relationship, the one where you can predict one from the other, I want to predict a value from another value. For example, now, I want to predict blood pressure of a person from the age, from the shot it's taking, the amount of daily salt, from other thing, from the height, from the weight, I want to predict the blood pressure. In that case, the scale is our table. The dependent is the first one, the scale. The independent can be any, when they say enemy, it can be categorical, it can be continuous, it can be district, it can be ordinary, it can be anything. So sometimes it can be one or two, or more than one. But if it is only one, it's a simple. So regression, linear regression, whenever the outcome is continuous, you are predicting a continuous outcome from any type of variable. either one of those things or many of them is simple, is regression. But if it is only one of the outcome variable you are predicting, that's simple regression. If it is more than one, two, three, four, as many as possible, that is multiple regression, and that's what we call multivariable analysis. It's not multivariate, it's multivariable. Now, so if is it that if that is difficult, but if it is transformed data, that is, if but it doesn't even make any difference. Transform the data. Okay, you can transform the data. Okay, what it says is that if it doesn't follow normal distribution, you just have to transform, because there's no, you don't have no parameter. Well, you don't have no parameter for it. The one that will have being a non-parameter for his logistic, but he cannot, because logistic is just for categorical variable. So there's no non-parametric. So if it doesn't follow, you just transform it to make sure it follow number distribution. Well, you know, there is something that statistics also cannot solve. There are many things it cannot still solve. Statistics come out of human curiosity, human intelligence, and people try to solve problems, but we have not been able to solve the world problem. Now, if the what you are predicting is categorical, look at it, and there are two categories. Binary, that's binary, is, and look at it also. The exposure can be anything, can be numerical, continuous, categorical, or whatever. But the outcome, what determines the type of regression is the outcome. A is linear regression. If it is categorical, logical regression. If it is two, the two categories, that is like a clinician like that, two categories, discharged, not discharged, dead or alive, treated, not treated, successful, surgery, successful, not successful, your dichotomized outcome. So, and that's why most, the type of regression you see in medical literature is logistic more than linear. Because the clinical, the clinician like to have a cutoff point. I just say anything below this one. No, somebody that has blood sugar 125 is not diabetic. The other one has 126 is diabetic. Can you see? So let's continue. Then assessing the relationship between two categorical variables. Now, if you look at this one up here. Two, both of them, they are scale and scale. You do regression. When both of them are category and category, like what you can do also to even this scale and scale, where I was talking of maybe age and blood pressure, you can categorize your age and blood pressure. Or naturally, it will not become this. Or naturally, it may be like that. Like what example usually use, sex and socioeconomic status, or employment status. Are you employed or not employed? Are you male or female? It doesn't have to be two categories, it can be many categories. But you are looking at association between two categorical variables. That's chi-square. And that's the commonness test that people are familiar with. And that was why, after we did our training on a workshop on using SPSS, the first one we did was chi-square, to discuss chi-square. But that's the commonness people are familiar with. And we went to town on the different type of questions. And we follow up with a workshop to know how to calculate, run every form of chi-square that are relevant for this type of analysis. Well, we have different type of, even meta-analysis is chi-square you use. So there are many other things you use it for. Even all these Krukawali also is not parametric for the Friedman, they are chi-square. Even the worst statistic you use in for odd ratio, when you do logistic regression, is chi-square. So we went to time piercing chi-square to know how to understand and how to calculate piercing, corrected, we use corrected chi-square, likelihood ratio chi-square, chi-square for trend, chi-square for test of goodness of it, Mark-Nehmer chi-square, Mark-Nehmer Balker. We talk about all those things. That's relationship or association between two categories. Now, The last of the table here. Oh, well, not the last, per se. Let's see a summary one. So look at this one. One scale depending on several independent variables. So that was what, when the situation, you know, what I just explained here is one, the delegation I talk about here, one outcome, one exposure. But sometimes you can have many exposure. Okay, now, scale. When you have scale here, which is, how to correct it, which is continuous, and the independent, you have binary, you have scale also. That is, no, we say that your independent, your exposure can be anything. And once they are more than one, maybe they can be anything. One can be binary, one can be continuous. Also, just like you are trying to look at predictors of blood pressure. Age is there, sex is there. Sex is binary, age is continuous. So it's multiple regression. The issue there is that simple. Anytime you have more than one variable as predictor of a continuous variable in regression, it's multiple regression, multiple variable analysis. If it is your outcome categorical, it's multiple logistic regression. If it is continuous, multiple linear regression. Now, these are some consideration anyway. Nominal independent group. When your, that is, the first independent is nominal, the other one is nominal. Okay, all this one here, we have already said that the outcome is one scale, one numerical. But all these are first exposure, second exposure rather. First independent, second independent. Well, sometimes when you have nominal and nominal, both of them, you can still do, because anytime you want to do regression with anything categorical, either that particular thing is the hardcore or exposure, you must create a dummy variable. Irrespective, that is, either you are dealing with the linear regression or logistic regression, you must create a dummy variable. So, can still use regression, but people are advocating both on the two exposure variable, they are categorical. You can use two-way ANOVA. You want to see that ANOVA and regression, they are the same. They are two faces of the same coin. So when we go for our workshop on ANOVA and regression, we do one ANOVA, the regression is separate. You will realize, the people that will attend will realize that ANOVA and regression are two faces of the same coin. They are the same thing. You know, in the intelligent people, researchers like you are intelligent people. You may see somebody may be working in Canada doing something, and somebody here in Kano is doing similar thing in different way. In different way. And they are actually doing the same thing in different way. And that was what happened to ANOVA and regression. Over the years, the researchers that were interested in experimental research, because they like to control for their confounders. Confounders are extraneous, other variables that may influence your result. Like now, you want to look at association between two variables. You have another variable that may serve as confounder. Like now, if you are talking of all these issues of hypertension, what are those factors? And you are looking at salt intake and some other things, obesity and whatever. PMI. The age is a confounder because as the person is growing old also, the risk. So there are many things that can serve as confounder. So if you, the experimental researcher, from the outset, they want to control for everything. They want to remove everything. That's why at the end of the day, what they help of getting with experimental research, they are planting as the best evidence. You know, sometimes when some people, they say evidence-based practice. The best evidence are efficacy, not effectiveness, anyway, because they have already controlled for too many things from the beginning. So, and that's what comes, bring out the factorial design where they have group. You can have somebody doing experimental design, they can have 8 groups, and this one are male, they are not taking this, these are male, are taking this, these, they are smokers. me, no smoker. Then me, smoker, no alcohol, you know? A female is a smoker. Then female, no smoker, not taking it. So they just, maybe you just have about 50-50 or 20-20 in each group. And when you manage it, or maybe all of them 150 or 160, they have already gotten 8 groups. So they use ANOVA a lot because there are many factors that are involved now. Look at what I said when they say variable. Number one, what example I give now, sex is there, male, female. So it's a variable. If I say alcohol, not alcohol, it's a variable. Cigarette, tobacco, not tobacco, it's a variable. So you can have 3 variables now. Factor into, by the time you have that, you may begin to have 12 groups. You have 12 when you multiply all those things. You have 12 different groups. And now you also have one. You use ANOVA. Mount yourself.
Let go.
Who is that? Somebody is disturbing. I think it's I muted the person.
Yeah.
Thank you. Now, so you know the experimental researcher, because they control for a lot of things, they like using ANOVA in those days. Then the observational, the people that are carrying, because you know a situation you can carry out experiment. So those people that take the research, like taking the research the way they are. Yeah, knowing that sometimes the experiment is not possible, we still have to carry, like in research now, in human research, it's difficult to, for ethical reasons, carry an experiment on human beings. You cannot even give somebody, okay, be smoking, if you give it a cigarette, be smoking. Let's see if you develop lung cancer. It's not ethically right. But you can go and study somebody that is smoking on his own. That's observational, but you cannot. So the people that get involved in observational, because those confounders, they are there. So they wait for it when they're analyzing, during analysis, they use regression to remove. But the logic, you now find that it's the same thing. So you see, people that come for workshop, you see that the same data set, the same thing. I will run ANOVA, we'll run regression, the same thing, you get the same result. And for you to be able to give you a clue, if you have been running ANOVA in regression before, you will see that it's an output called ANOVA. In regression, there's an output called ANOVA, part of the results, to leave for you to confirm the ANOVA and regression is the same. Now, nominal repeated measure, do we repeat ANOVA? Then we have nominal independent, nominal repeated measure means ANOVA. Then nominal and scale and cover. This one, and cover analysis of covariance is a blend between regression and ANOVA. We already said that. Regression and ANOVA is the same thing, but being done in different way. So sometimes you want to, you know, blend it together. Call it ANCOVA. So that is why, you know, somebody was suggesting that in the next training, ANOVA, that why not put mingle the T-test and ANOVA. Since it is comparing to me, the other one comparing. When I showed the what a lot of things are under this ANOVA, you need to understand. And once you understand it, will no more confuse you. So I think this is a summary. This one I've shown it before in one of these. This is just a summary. So make this simple, the simple way. All this talk. Look at the summary. What this one means that outcome, exposure, outcome. Exposure, if it's categorical, outcome is categorical, it's chi-square, and everything that related to it. You also, when you make it 2x2 table, you can do relative risk odd ratio. So they are about categorical and categorical, like smoking and lung cancer. Lung cancer, yes or no. Smoking, yes or no. So both of them are categorical. They are 2x binary. That's why you can easily calculate relative risk or odd ratio. With them, and you can run chi square because it's categorical. But if it is, you have categorical, two categories, a numerical outcome. That's what we just said before. When you say you are looking at mean between two groups, that is t-test, different type of t-test, and their non-parametric counterpart. If you are looking at the categorical exposure and numerical outcome, but when category is three or more, supposed to be three or more, greater than three or more, you are talking of ANOVA. And the non-parametric counterparts are the Krukawali, median test, Friedman, ANOVA. Then numerical and numerical, that is numerical and categorical. Outcome is categorical. The exposure is numerical. There is no, is unless you opt for logistic regression, for regression, logistic regression. You see all these other ones also. You can do logistic regression. You can do either logistic or linear regression, because all these initial analysis, they are more like preliminary. Nowadays, that you want to look at factor responsible for something. When you first of all do all this, you need to end up with regression. Then numerical, I've already said it. You're talking of correlation. If it is both of them are continuous, Pearson. If not all of them are continuous, you look at Spearman or Kendall. Now, if you don't look at this side, before I talk about the last one, look at this side, color differently. You see that these are the regression you can do for each other. So you notice something. Whenever the outcome is numerical, it's linear regression. Whenever the outcome is categorical, it's logistic regression. And the linear regression or logistic regression, when the exposure are only one also, is simple linear or simple logistic. When the exposure are more than one, multiple linear or multiple logistic, or what we call multivariable analysis, not multivariate analysis. Before I go down to that one, the logistic, you know, this category, the outcome is categorical. If there are two categories, like dead or alive, now it's binary logistic because there are two categories of outcome. If you have more than two categories of outcome, maybe you will see dead, alive, but not or something. No, you have two categories. Example, you can, when you assess the outcome, you may say that good, fair, poor, whatever. You have more than two categories of outcome, the possible value of the outcome. That would be multinomial logistic regression. When it is not binomial, if those outcome, more than two outcomes, are ranked, are ordinal, that is, they are like maybe something like socioeconomic that are middle, lower, middle, upper. They are ranked. They are not just more than two, but they are in order. That is, you can use ordinal logistic regression. Now, I said something. I said this multiple regression, that is, when your outcome are more than one, when you have more than one, exposure variable. Multivariable and not multivariate, because many people say multivariate, not multivariate. Look at example here. Multivariate down here. More than one exposure. The exposure is more than one. The outcome is more than one. That is multivariate. That is the multivariate analysis. The one that are there are multivariate analysis of variant, maneuver, factor analysis, multidimensional scaling, discriminant. Analysis, principal components, analysis, all those things, they are multivariate analysis. Because on both sides, you have many variables. That is, on the exposure side, there are many variables. On the outcome side, there are many variables. That is multivariate. That is the multivariate analysis. The one we do, multiple regression, multiple logistic, multiple linear regression, they are actually multivariable analysis. But many people make the mistake. So if you want to confirm, you can get to standard statistic review. Not all those small ones, standard one. Not all those ones, and also if you will be able to get the truth. I think we'll stop here for question. I'm sure you have question. So we can entertain question. If you have chatted, yes, we have 20 on board. Let me see, somebody has chatted. Let's see. Let me see the chat. Now for the lecture. Oh, it's not question, it's time. Okay, thank you. Yes, if you have question, you can ask. Unmute yourself and ask. If you don't want to ask, you can send it as text. I will know if you want to, you don't want people to read it, you can send to me privately. Private, as you can say, private. And I will not make mention of your name, I will just answer it. Thank for the lecture. I hope we'll be able to get it. Yes, we'll get, you know, the I'm working, you know, the problem with video is they are heavy to upload, to upload, or even to download, even to upload. So what I've resulted into, I've gotten YouTube account. I'll put it there. By from next week, even maybe from Monday or Tuesday, it will be ready. So you can access it. So somebody is asking question. Sir. Yes, Dr. Shushi.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening. Please, somebody is making noise.
Good evening, sir. Thank you very much.
Welcome.
Good evening. Thank you very much for the presentation, sir.
You're welcome.
Yes, I have a question, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir. Can I continue, sir?
Yes, go on.
Okay, sir. I want to ask, sir, if we have a Likert scale.
Yes.
We have a scale that is Likert scale.
Yes.
But the interpretation of scores. If the interpretation of scores is in mean scores. Quality of life scale, for example. The quality of life scale is a 5 Likert scale. After measurement, the scores now, they are mean scores. Mean scores are being generated from the life. So what we are comparing now is going to be the mean scores of... So if we are comparing the mean scores of the groups, in the scale, are we still going to say that the mean score statistics for the mean scores, or we are going to use non-parametric statistics for the mean scores?
Thank you. That's a very good question.
That is my question, sir.
Yeah, that's a very good question. You know, all those quality of life scale you are talking of, they even have different domain, but they have some way they calculate and calculate mean. So when you bring it in, it has bringing continuity into it. Yes, I'm now. So once you is not the final score you are generating, they are mean of those score. So you can actually, they can follow normal distribution because it becomes continuous variable. Continuous variable means that in between two values, there are infinite number of values. So between, if the Likert scale that is 1 to 5, now between 4 and 5, if you use the mean, there are infinite value that can be there. You can get 4.102, 4.3, infinite number. So it becomes continuous in that sense. So you can use it as parametric. And another thing is that they even apart from that, they also add them together to form a composite for each domain. Go on. You still want to ask questions?
Yes, sir. Then, other questions, sir. Yes, sir. Then another question I want to ask is, you said that regression is used to deal with confounders. Now,
multiple regression,
linear regression. Mm-hmm. Yes, sir. Simple linear regression, does it also... Simple linear regression, does it deal with confounders?
No, you cannot deal with confounder now because it's only one. You can deal with confounder when you have more than one. You are trying to remove the confounding effect of the other one. So simple linear regression is like any other, is bivariate in the sense like chi square, t test, and all those other ones. Or one way and over. It's the same as those ones. It's not, you cannot use it. It's when you want to use to do control for confounder, you run multiple. So what you is this, where you do simple as one of the steps for multiple, because you first go run 1, 1, 1 for each of those factors. No, both the factor you are studying and the factor, other factor that may serve as confounder, you run in 1, 1, 1, simple for them. For you to, if you are dealing with linear regression, it will give you the regression coefficient, the Harris square, the equation and determination that will make you to know the contribution of each of them before you now start combining them. So we need to do stepwise regression. So those the stepwise regression is to remove the confounder, is what you use in the multiple regression. Yes. To remove part of confounder.
Okay, so after the simple regression, I'll go further to do the multiple to deal with confounders.
Yes.
The reason why I'm asking is if the outcome is continuous, if the outcome variable is continuous variable, I can only use a linear.
It's linear, yes. It's linear regression, yes. Unless if you
but now. But if I want to deal with confounders, okay, sir.
Yes. So when we are doing, you can be part of our this is when we are doing. It will be upper. We cannot just no. After the ANOVA, that's where we do the regression. You see the way it is done. No, those things better to be part of it.
Okay.
Yes,
okay,
any other
sir.
Question? I can see some people.
Okay, sir.
On the, do you see a question?
And this is also.
Do you see a question? Okay, somebody wrote. There is a trend towards structural equation modeling. Where does this come in all you have described? That's the regression, and regression is the modeling, the multiple regression. What it means that you want to know out of many factors, you know, when you do your literature review, there are many factors that will tell you are responsible, you collect data on those factors. But when you begin to analyze, you discover that some of them, some things are confounding for some of them. So there are some confounders. At the end of the day, you now come down to manageable number, those on the half effect. You now use to form equations. So we have an example of that. I was showing some people that came for workshop. There is one I did for somebody in part two, Ebony. So it's about peak expiratory flow rate. And the factors among children, secondary school students, the factors responsible are height, weight, sex, and some other things. Then age, yes, height. So when we discover that height, you know, is the best factor, it gives the highest coefficient of determination, followed by weight, followed by is it age, sex, yes, sex, and some other things. But we later, when we were now doing the multiple combining them, we discovered that the weight does not even contribute. What you are showing in weight is the height, because normally, if somebody is tall, it's going to weigh more than everybody that is not tall. So we discovered that it was weight, it was height. Height, even sex, even contribute more than weight. So, and we now had the equation that now combine height, I don't know if the weight was still there, but weight was not as important. Yes, I think weight was there, but was not as important as sex. So height was the, in the equation, height was the first, then I think it's sex, then age. I think weight was even knockout. Then age and sex. So we are now give the equation. So that people, by the time you, what it just means is that if you feed in that equation, you for a particular person, and you feed in all those information, you're able to predict what the peak expiratory flow rate should be for that person. So another question. Thank you. I don't know if I've answered that person's question. That person I'll talk about structural equation. Then thank you, sir, for the lecture. Yeah, I joined late. So this person was talking about video. Somebody has asked of it. The video, I'm already uploading the video on YouTube, but it will be ready next week. You just link through my website. The website I referred you to before, I wasn't satisfied with what they, so I'm doing another one. who is almost ready. She was all to be ready this week, but before I was there, was yesterday. So by next week, if you be there, I'll just, maybe on Tuesday, I'll just say, go to the website, be able to link with the all the videos you will be there. Because the problem with videos, if you see, to attach video, because it's very heavy, it's very, very heavy. So we put it, even some of the workshop I did, to attach video, some of them will know that it takes time. Even after I send it to them, they said they cannot download it, so that's just it. So you get it on the website, you get the link to the through the website. I think I've answered that. Then please, there is an equation asked by examiner, and that is, what are the ways of handling confounders in this site? And that is, we'll talk about that. Okay, one of these days, okay, what will happen is that by next week now, because there is going to be training on ANOVA, I will be saying something about ANOVA. But it's good for you to be part of the workshop, because being part of the workshop makes you to be, you don't know anything until you do it. That's just it. You don't know anything if you don't practice it, until you see the way it is. So statistics is about reading, the practice, reading, practice, reading, practice. That's where it sticks. If you listen to the lecture, you may be excited, but until you know how to, and even when you learn it, it's good to be practicing. You can be helping people to analyze data. That was what I was doing, even as a resident. I just collect data from my colleagues. Okay, your research, you bring it. Let me help you. I will run the analysis. Now, you start from there. So be part of the, if you are there, you'll be able to understand the confounder. Though I will give, by when we are giving, maybe the week, I'll be doing training on this, on regression. I will talk about that confounder issue. Error is under potential error in measurement. You will talk about systematic error bias, all those random errors and systematic error, which is bias. So confounder is one under systematic error. We talk about it. Then thank you, sir. It's very nice and helpful. Okay. Thank you. Okay. Any question? No other question? It's like that. See. You can test your question, you can ask.
Thank you very much, brother.
You're welcome, Dr. Oko. Okay, sir.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Just to say thank you.
Yeah. Now, there will be training. I want as many people that can be part of training that start tomorrow using SPSS. Though we have done it for 2 weekends before we started all those other training. There's somebody now, some people are now calling that are we not having another session? Because I also discovered most of the people that come for the other training, when we demonstrate with the SPSS, because nowadays nobody studies statistics you run statistics with software now. It's not with hand. Especially when you're having large sample size, how many will you be doing? So by the time you are likely to make mistakes. And when you begin to have a group data, you lose value. But computer, there's nothing like group data in computer. It just runs, even if there are millions, it will run it for you. So it's good for you to know, when you understand the concept, how do you run it? Well, if you don't want to know also, but when it is run, the result comes out, you must know how to interpret also. Because if you are reading a journal, when they talk about odds ratio, confidence interval, what does it mean? You know all those things. So you should be able to know how to interpret. And that is why you be part of the training. We discovered that people that know how to at least find their way, navigate through SPSS, they participate more and they tend to gain more. So that is why we just encourage. It's just for you to, it may not make you superstar in it, but at least some people cannot even enter, they cannot even put their data in the SPSS. We calling people. Even if you want to send data for someone to analyze, you must be able to put it somewhere and send it to that person. So how to navigate through SPSS is what we are doing now, because it will not come up again until maybe October. So you can make yourself available. So somebody wanted to ask question. Go on. Sito, you want to ask question? Okay. Any other question? Okay, there's no question. That's great. So you get other information. If you are not on the WhatsApp group, you can chat your number so that you can include it. Chat, you can chat it privately. If you don't want people to see, just chat it privately. I will include it on the WhatsApp group. If you are not on it, you can chat your number.
All right. Thank you, sir. Good night, sir.
You're welcome, bro. Good night, sir.
Thank you, sir. Okay, sir.
Thank you, sir.
You're welcome. Welcome.